I believe that when we see other people, except under very extraordinary circumstances, we see an illusion that we project upon them. Mostly, it's a simplifying illusion. We don't see the whole person. Partly, I suppose, because we couldn't tolerate the complete vision. It would be too much for us, you know. So our doors of perception are three quarters closed, and exactly why that is isn't obvious. But I do believe that the more accurately you perceive a person, the more you perceive them in the manner that you described. You see this eternal, recurring, conscious hero striving against the darkness. And when you treat people like that, of course they're compelled by that. It's a compelling way to be interacted with. Although, I don't know what it is that maybe it's not obvious how much of that you can tolerate, which is a very strange thing too. You know, I'm thinking about this. Most of what we perceive is our memory. And sometimes that is stripped away and we see what's there, but seeing what's there is awe-inspiring. It's gripping and it instills terror. And I think that's the same as the burning bush. And in some sense, everything is a burning bush. But you're blinded to it. You see what's there, I think, when you really love someone. Love seems to, like I always thought, when people fall in love with one another, they see the perfection that could conceivably exist. It's like the curtains of illusion pull apart momentarily, and you see the paradisal state that could be there hypothetically if everything was done properly. And that drives the love. And then maybe if you work across time, you can achieve that to some degree. You know, because other people think about themselves as deluded when they're in love. And that's a very cynical way of looking at it. It certainly doesn't apply to the love between a parent and a child. You see that meaningful fragility in your children, and it's beautiful. And maybe if you've been warped and hurt, you get resentful about it and jealous of it, and that can lead to all sorts of terrible things. But to the degree that you're privileged to see that, that calls you to be a better person. So then, but what you see there is if you view someone with love, then it's incumbent upon you to treat them as if they're valuable. And then the more you treat other people as if they're valuable, the better person you are. That just comes along for the ride in some sense. So none of that seems questionable to me. That seems solid. And so then maybe the more love you view other people with, the higher the moral demand that's placed on you. And then I would say too, well then, that's another reason why it's so important to be truthful and in some sense to be good, because it isn't obvious to me that you can withstand that moral load if you're compromised by too much sin. It's too much. And that's another thing that we're not very good at teaching young people about. You know, you shouldn't do that. You know, it's like there's a sanctimonious authority that goes along with that that's the wrong tone. It's more like you know, I don't know how you lay it out properly, but you tell people that you love how to avoid the road to hell. And you don't do that because you're shaking your finger at them or because you're a moral authority. You do it because you don't want them to burn. And I think there's too much of the moral authority still in the church and not enough of the, you know, the love that helps people avoid the fire.